high desert and the great American Southwest. I bid you all good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you may be in the world's prolific time zones. It's going to be a really interesting night. I've got a guest coming up the network doesn't know about because I didn't tell them, for a good reason. There are things that... I don't know what this is going to be. I'll tell you all about it in a moment. Brendan Cook and Barbara Macbeth in the next hour with, I think, one of the most interesting things on radio. They bring us voices from the grave, literally from the grave. Now, this is done with electronic voice phenomena, currently using digital technology in graveyards and prisons and places like that. They tend to go, but you can get them anywhere, and it's all done to the highest quality standards. And, you know, we'll explain the whole thing to you, but I mean, it's voices from the grave. It's a pretty serious matter. And so, perhaps, is what I'm about to do. You tell me, if you did a show like this, and you received an email like this, what you would do. It says, Art, I know a man who ordered a UFO shot down and later flew with it in a C-130 to the U.S. with two Greys in body bags. He was a brigadier general in the South African Army. He heard Bob Lazar tell you that the ship he had shot down is now at Area 51. It is the small ship in the back of the hangar with a dent in it. The dent was made by what was used to shoot it down. He would like to tell you the story if you want to hear it. Please let us know. Thanks, Bruce. And then I've got a phone number here. So, needless to say, I called Bruce and then spoke with another man we will call Chris, who says he was a brigadier general in the South African Army and did exactly what you just heard about. So in a moment, I have no idea what's about to ensue. In a moment, that's exactly what we're going to do. Okay, then, let's do this, shall we? And by the way, the reason I did not tell the network I was going to have this guest is because the man, I understand, and we'll find out more here in a moment, is in fear of his life. And so with that in mind, I thought it better not to call attention to it ahead of time for those who might want to, I don't know, trace our line or something. Hey there, Bruce.
Yeah.
Welcome to the program.
Thank you, Art.
I wanted to just confirm, you know, with the audience and with you that you did send the email that I read here a moment ago on the air.
Yes, I did.
You did.
And, Art, I really don't have anything to say. I'll just let, you know, you talk to the brigadier. But I do want to thank you and Art, I mean, you and George for your service as fellow servicemen. I was in Vietnam, and all of us appreciate what you guys do.
Well, thank you.
Program where we can really get truth out.
Thank you for your service.
Okay.
All right, here comes Chris.
Yes.
Chris?
Yes.
Welcome to the program. You're going to have to get real close to the telephone and talk real loud for us.
Okay.
If you're able to. That's really good. Okay. Chris, you were a brigadier general in the South African Army, is that correct?
Yes, I was. I was attached to special ops and special units.
Special ops and special units in the South African Army.
That's right.
All right. I guess you should just begin at the beginning of your story. In what year was this?
This happened in 1982. The event took place in 1982. It happened... let me go a little bit back, because I didn't do the 2 years as required by law, as we had drafting to do, and I only did 3 months of the year, because the other time of the year I was normally away at sea, as my profession as a marine engineer took me away from home a lot.
Okay,
you know,
how does a marine engineer get involved in a UFO story?
I was the officer on duty the night when this incident happened. I mean, I was the base commander on duty the night it happened.
Okay.
It's normally not my task to do things for the Air Force in general, but...
Chris, I don't know how much you can tell us. For example, can you tell us what base you were at?
I was at the Pretoria base, just stationed outside Pretoria.
Okay.
At the Air Force base. I was stationed out there. I was not... you've got to understand that the Air Force base there is very well protected. It's got big walls and stuff around it. It's very hard to get in because they do a lot of secret work there, too.
Okay.
They do a lot of research there for the military. And to understand that, you've got to understand at the time when this happened somewhere in November in 1982, and what happened is I was called up to the tower of the Air Force base, and I was told that we have an incision coming in.
That you have a what coming in?
We have had a problem. As you knew, the country has been at war for 25 years. And we had a lot of Mengs coming over the border into the country. And the sergeant on duty in the tower said that the radar has picked up two bogeys coming in.
And they presumed at that point that they were MiGs. What country typically would send aircraft over South Africa?
It would be normally from Mozambique or from Angola.
Okay.
As people don't know, in this country, a lot of people from Cuba was the fighting in Angola, and there was a lot of Russians there, too, at the time, fighting during the war we had. A lot of people died, and terrorism was very high at the time.
Indeed.
So the next thing happened is I was called up and told that there was a... And Air Force is not my duty, actually. I was just the base commander on duty because the other people were away at a function.
So you had you just happened to sort of have duty or pick it up?
I had to pick it up, yes.
Gotcha. Okay, officer on duty.
I was the officer on duty.
Commander, actually.
And they told me that these two Minks are coming in, and we had to virtually take care of this because if we have... soldiers on the ground, it could be a threat to the soldiers on the ground on the borders.
Of course.
And the first thing I turned around, I asked the sergeant on duty, I asked the gunnery sergeant, as you would know them in this country, as gunnery sergeant, we know them as adjutant. I asked the adjutant, I said, adjutant, what you've got to go out to investigate? He said, no, we have a problem, the Navy has a problem looking for... one of the Russians' submarines is playing games out at sea, and most of the aircraft out there are trying to hunt it down to chase it out of the water space, out of the country's borders.
So, in other words, the resources you had were occupied sub-hunting?
About 2,000 miles away, yes.
Uh-huh.
And next thing that what happened is I said to them, well, where is the F-1 Mirages? I don't know if you can explain to your audience what that is. That's a French-built fighter jet.
And I would imagine South Africa purchased them from France.
From France.
Yes, Mirages, yes.
The thing is with that, it's also the only one which is capable of carrying a nuclear weapon. The thing is, they said all the F-1s are out.
By the way, General?
Yes.
May I ask you a quick question related? You mentioned nuclear weapons.
Yes.
It's long been thought that South Africa possesses nuclear weapons. Is that true?
It is true. We have tested it in the desert a long time ago.
Uh-huh.
And the funny thing about it is we got busted by the Weather Channel.
The Weather Channel?
Yes.
They detected the anomaly that was the test.
Yeah, they detected the anomaly in the test, and it was known through the world that...
I really like the Weather Channel. I've always liked the Weather Channel. All right, now even more. So they found your test. Well, all right, here you are thinking that you're being you're being invaded. Your ground troops could be in trouble. This aircraft is the aircraft, two of them, I guess, are identified coming in, and you don't have any resources to, or what do you have?
Well, they turned around and said there is an F-1. As I mentioned, the base does a lot of secret work for the government. It does a lot of testing and stuff in that base. And they turned around and said there is an F-1 Mirage, which they do doing an experimental stuff with. And I asked them, well, we just need to see what is out there, so send it out there and see what's going on. Mm-hmm. So the pilot came and he took off and he came back and he said that we have one bogey here. I said, well, we've seen two on screen, and then we have another radar base which can go out to about 1,500 miles into enemy territory. Mm. They confirmed that the other one has broken off and took off to another direction the other way.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, so I thought at the time, I said, well, we guided the F-1 Mirage towards where it was by radar, and next thing, you know, he said, this is not an Mink. You must remember, this is at night. It's pitch dark, and he turns around, and the pilot turns around and says, this is not a Mink. This is something else. So I turned around and said, is this a civilian aircraft by any chance? Who we are mistaking as a Mink by any chance? And he said, no, it's not. I said, is it carrying any weapons or anything? And he said, no. And there was a bit of confusion going on.
Or no apparent weapons.
No apparent weapons or anything. And I said, do you think this thing's going to be hostile towards us? And he said, I don't know. And with that, I don't know. I don't want to take chances. So I said to him, well, do you have any weapons? He says, yeah, I have a weapon. And I said, but what do you got? I mean, and then the sergeant turned around and says, he doesn't have any arms to fire anything at him. I said, well, try and scare him out of there. And he says, no, well, I've got a weapon I can use, but it's very close range, and I have to go pretty high and do a dive onto this thing. And he made a dive and...
General, what kind of weapon was he referring to?
They were testing, and at that time I didn't know what it was. I didn't know. They just told me it was a laser beam. I didn't know what a laser beam was at that time.
I see.
A year later, I found out what it was really about.
But it was an airborne laser on a F-1 Mirage.
Yes.
Which your country had to be nuclear capable.
Well, yes. I don't want to mention a country, but there was another country who was sponsoring this project.
Sounds like us.
No.
No?
No.
Okay, well...
Normally what happens with the South African... I don't know if the world knows that South Africa is normally... is the third weapons manufacturer in the world. It's the third biggest in the world.
Yeah, it's right up there. No
it's
question
right
about
up
it.
There.
Yeah. So he dove his plane and used a laser against this... did he describe the form of this thing? Could he see...
He did. He said, this thing is round, man. It's got no wings and stuff like that. And you must remember, we're not speaking English. We're speaking our home language, which is either Dutch or Afrikaans.
Do you recall at what speed he estimated it?
He estimated it around about close to 700 miles an hour.
In level flight?
In level flight.
In level flight, all right. And it was round, a disc?
And a disc. He said it was a disc. And I turned around and I said, who the hell is experimenting with discs out here?
Uh-huh.
And the people said, nobody. And I said, well, then I turned around, get up there and see what you can do, bring it down. Let's get it out of here. Because if it's hostile towards the forces on the ground,
right.
I don't want it to get too close to the forces because...
So you basically authorized an attack on this craft.
Well, I had no option. I mean...
I know, I'm not faulting you. I'm just being straight here. You authorized the attack.
That's right.
And then I guess he took the Mirage up and dove on this thing and let it have it with what laser he had on board. And then what?
He hit it. It spinned first to the right, and then spin to the left almost. It was hit very hard, and because he was carrying enormous equipment on it, he couldn't stay long. But by that time, I had another Mirage out there from the north, who was doing a patrol out at Southwest Africa, which is Namibia today, along the Skeleton Coast.
Yes.
Came in and took over from him. For about 20 minutes, this thing just bounced around like a ball. And you know, the pilot, you know, couldn't do that.
So it was out of control.
It was out of control. It just bounced around like a ball. And when it finished me, eventually it stopped bouncing around. It just slowly went down and hit the ground. And we sent out a helicopter to go and find out if any survivors. Because I was more concerned about POWs, Russian POWs.
Sure. You've got to remember, everybody, you wouldn't be thinking UFO. Even after that description, you would think that would not be the case, and you'd be, believe me.
I'm thinking aircraft.
Sure.
Know, like a Russian aircraft or anything. And the problem is, the previous year, they did shoot down some Russian pilots, and it embarrassed the government quite a lot, actually, because the pressure really came on to them.
So you dispatched a helicopter out to the crash site, which was about how far at this point from you?
It took the helicopter about 1,200 miles away from me, I was standing at the time.
Gotcha.
The helicopter came, developed some mechanical problems just about 2 miles away from it, and it had to land. But there was incision group. We had recce's on board. We had 4 recce's on board so they can investigate. That's like the Green Beret.
General, do you recall the nature of the mechanical problems, and do you think it was related to what had crashed?
At the time, I didn't think so. I just thought it was pure, because the helicopters are really run very hard in Africa. They don't sit on the ground. They work very hard.
Gotcha.
And I thought it was one of that, but eventually it had to be something to do with the crash. And some people complained from months afterwards about when they got too close to this, that they got ill and started vomiting and stuff like that. Hmm. About 5 hours after the accident, then we could approach it, but it was glowing like rainbow colors and stuff like that by the time I got there.
It was, say that again, please. It was what?
It was like a glowing like a rainbow in different colors.
Uh-huh.
Like blues and oranges and greens and stuff like that.
Did that glow extend a long distance from it, or just was the object itself glowing that way?
The object itself was glowing that way.
Gotcha. Estimation of size?
The estimation of size about this is about 12 foot in diameter.
At this point, I assume you're getting reports by radio.
No, I was getting reports, and then I got in touch with the general, which is the commander-in-chief of the forces, and he said, you better get out there and find out what the hell you shot down, because I don't want to have trouble.
Yeah, you know, typical reaction, right?
A typical reaction.
And so you got in a helicopter yourself, or what?
I got into a helicopter, and I have my own team of people who work with me, because my real job was anti-terrorism, to run after the terrorists to put bombs down.
Yes, sir.
And what happened is my team jumped onto to helicopter, and we ran out there. And surprise, surprise, we found around this. But at the time, being ignorant, or I don't know, we're not trained in this kind of stuff.
Of course not.
I didn't know what UFO meant till that time, you know. It didn't exist in my gallery, and all the people around me know what to do with it.
So here's this glowing, rainbow-like colors disc, 12 feet roughly in diameter, sitting on the ground, no doubt with some kind of damage, I would assume?
There was a... It eventually the colors went out. They had a damage that had a huge dent about the size of a basketball in the U.S. standard.
That would be the impact of the laser weapon?
Laser weapon impact, yes.
Okay, and about how long did it take for this glowing to cease?
The glowing from the shooting down time till then, it took about 5 hours. then even then when we touched it, it hurt. You know,
it hurt as in what? As in electric shock? As in just pain or what?
It's like giving you cramps when you touch it.
Like any what?
Like your hand goes numb and getting cramps and pain and all kinds of funny things.
Okay, got it.
You know what I'm saying? It's like a bee sting, but it ain't a bee sting.
Ain't a bee sting. General, hold on. A brigadier general from the South African Army, and we are not done. He shot down a UFO, but we're not done. There were things inside.
Writing with the After Dark newsletter. Subscribe by calling 1-888-727-5505. With Art Bell. Call the Wildcard Line at area code 775-727-1295. The first time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5. And dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
And this is one of those moments. Be assured, this would be one of those moments in radio history where you get to do something a little bit different. A brigadier general from the South African Army who ordered the shoot down of a UFO. In a moment, we continue. Well, all right, General, welcome back. Let's pick right up. I mean, here you are out in, what was the lay of the land like where this thing crashed?
It's pretty near to the Kruger National Park and the borders.
Oh, this was near Kruger National Park.
Yes.
Okay.
But it's very pretty. The area where it fell is also a very restricted area because this was a heavy patrolled area for soldiers to patrol by foot, and many soldiers lost their lives on these patrols against terrorists and insurgents and stuff like that, trying to get into the country to put bombs in the streets.
Understood. All right. This thing is on the ground, and it's apparently after hours. You waited while the glowing to touch it, you said, hurt. So I assume everybody waited until all of this faded, or what happened next?
Well, what happened next, the following, we couldn't touch it. Everybody complained and started getting sick in that. And then it took there was already a truck there already, a gas truck, we call it petrol, a gas truck there, Mercedes-Benz military truck there already, But this thing was quite heavy. We couldn't, once it cooled down and everything else, it's like it was going through a cooling process.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, one of the lieutenants turned around and said, "Sir, please take a look. That hatch is open."
That hatch is open?
Yes.
Okay.
He put my attention to it and he says, "I don't know if it's, I hope there's no hostile coming out of this thing because we got, you know, all we got is R1s and R4s, which is Gala guns, and a few mortars, and that's it. And we've got no way of fighting this thing." You know, at the time, and that's from what I felt. I call the perimeter off, and I'm very nervous because we are very close to the border.
How many of you were there?
We were approximately, there was, the patrols that normally go out on what we call patrols, border patrols, the people who do the foot walk. The actual fact is, I lift my hat up for those guys because they had a 100-pound backpack to carry, and they had, some of them had to walk around about 600 miles in 30 days, patrol the border.
About how many, General?
They were normally about between 12 and 24.
So somewhere in that range, we're with you, next to this crashed object. One of them says the hatch is opening. Did you get a look at the hatch?
No, I didn't take a look at the hatch. It was morning. The morning was breaking already. And I had the hatch is open. So one of the recce's decided, "Well, I'm going to take a look. What the heck is this thing?" And he opened it up. And I said, I ordered him to get away from it. I don't know what it is. And he said, "Gee whiskers, where's this child? How come they have a child in here?"
A child?
Yeah, because the object, the thing inside was like the size of a 10-year-old child, you know, it was small in body structure.
Yes.
And I said to him, "Get away from there," and he got away eventually. And then he says, "Well, they must have been burnt because they're gray as hell."
Gray.
Yeah, because he thought that there was a fire inside and they got, you know, the bodies got charred, you know, from the fire. Got
yes,
burnt.
Yes, yes, of course. So you had a small, apparent 10-year-old, chronologically, beings that were gray in color. Your man thought charred.
Yeah, and he thought they were charred. And I said, "Well," a few minutes later, I said, "Well, we got to clean up this mess. I got to go back to the base." And but there was one thing about it. While this thing was glowing and that, the patrol truck, which came up with to secure the perimeter around it, was a gas truck. It also cut out and had problems moving anywhere.
Uh-huh.
And then I said, "Well, we can't lift this thing up by ourselves. We have to call the engineers in with an engineering truck."
Sure.
Which has got a crane and a boom, and that was diesel, and nothing happened to that.
And so a diesel engine was unaffected?
It was unaffected for some reason or another. I don't know why. At the time, it could move, and we had power to lift this thing on the back of the truck.
Did you lift it and begin to move it with the beams still inside?
The beams were inside,
right.
Because I felt that this is not a place for this kind of investigation. And I made a phone call. The general told me that, is there any other pieces of it laying around? And I said, "No, the thing is intact. It's just got one hell of a dent in it." And
General, may I ask a question? At this time, were you beginning to think that you had perhaps had an extraterrestrial craft on your hands, or were you still thinking that it was a foreign test aircraft?
I thought it was a foreign test aircraft.
Gotcha. Okay.
That's the notion about it.
All right. So you had it then taken aback by engineers.
Yeah, the engineers lifted onto another diesel truck, and we started moving it through the Kruger National Park. At that time, what happened to the with the helicopter? Any thing at the time gets too close to it, it just cuts and dies, and you couldn't get it operated again.
Gotcha.
And so we moved it about 800 miles back to Pretoria to the secret base I talked to you about. Now, it's in the middle of the city. That's the big thing about it, and they do a lot of secret work there, actually. And people don't think about it. They don't even know about it. The thing is, we moved it to Pretoria, about 800 miles from the border, to the central of the country. Then it was moved to a base about 400 miles away from Cape Town called Esterplat.
Yes, sir.
And there it stayed for 3 days. Then I was out in, I was out in Pugalanga, another place looking for a terrorist. I was assigned to look for a terrorist. And I was called back to Pretoria. And the general turned around and said, "You have an assignment." I said, "No, I can't do this assignment. Please, Sir General, get somebody else to do it. Because my service time is almost over and I have to return back to my normal civil duties as an engineer."
Mm-hmm.
And he said, "No, you need to do it. You found this thing, you need to take care of it. And I don't want anything else more to do with it." So I said, "What do you want me to do with this thing?" And he said, "It's not ours, we got to give it back where it came from." And he said, "The plane is waiting for you at Esterplat. You have to go there. The plane there, the aircraft carrier, we had Hercules over there." And so
the Hercules C-130.
The C-31 was so already fueled up and ready to go, and the object is already loaded. And he said to me, "You got to take it to the U.S.
To the U.S.
To the U.S. And I said, "Well," and I'm really mad because my service time is nearly up, and I want to spend time with my family, which I normally don't, because when I finish my service, I leave the country to do my engineering work as a civil, as a marine engineer.
Yes.
And I was pretty mad, and I was really, really upset because it means I'm not going to see my family for a year. And
nevertheless, you pack this thing up.
And I just got to the base, and I told my group. Was already ordered by the general staff to be at the, they were flown there supply extra security with the plane. But then, and before they loaded the disc, but they didn't load the two body bags at the time.
Two body bags came separately?
The two body bags came separately at the time. And I asked them to open it up because I was very suspicious, and I had a very bad temper about things closed because of all the bombs and stuff we had dismantled in the past.
Makes sense.
And I said, "You open this damn thing. I don't want to, you know." And there was two gray people with very long fingers, and the eyes were, were bigger than horse eyes, you know what I'm saying? And I said, "Close the damn thing. I don't want to see this. I wanted to see if there's no explosives involved." And that thing had happened. They put these two grays on board, and...
But there was no mistaking what you saw, General.
There's no mistake what I saw, and I turned around and I said to my gunnery sergeant, I said to the adjutant, I said, "Are you playing games with me again?" You know, he had a bad habit of playing games on me. And he said, no, Brigadier, this is the real thing." I said, "Well, what the hell is this?" And he said, "I don't know. None of us knew, you know."
But they were claiming that this was going back where it belonged, to America. Can you tell us where in America you were going?
We were told at the time we had American pilots who flew the Herculeses. And we were told that the British pilot would meet us in Dassault, in Cape Verde's, and that pilot will take over from there because the U.S. pilots of U.S. origins have interests of conflict, so they can't make the flight into the U.S.
Uh-huh.
The flight from Cape Dassault took us to Washington, D.C. Outside Washington, D.C., that's where they do the U.S. Funerals and stuff on that base. I can't remember the name of it offhand right now.
Could it be Andrews Air Force Base?
Andrews Air Force Base, that's correct.
Uh-huh.
We arrived on time. Everything was doing very well. But during our flight, we experienced a lot of mechanical troubles, and a lot of things were going wrong with a brand new C-23, which has not done much hours.
130.
130.
General, I mean, certainly, if not prior to, then by the time you unzipped those body bags and saw those beings, you must have begun to be aware you had an extraterrestrial craft and beings on your hands.
When we were flying and I had the time to sit down and thinking, it hit me closer we got to the U.S., but only when I was the pressure was off me, I realized what the hell I did. Because when I was at sea on the ship, I have time for myself. And then I sort of figured out what was going on.
And by that you mean the order that you gave to have it shot down. You realized suddenly what you had done.
Okay. And there is one that during the flight woke up.
I beg your pardon? Did you say one woke up?
One woke up during the flight. And one of my men, who is always on patrol with me, took a butt of a gun and hit it. But he broke his fingers doing that.
Oh, my God.
It knocked it out. I don't know if it survived. All I wanted, then I panicked. And then all of us started panicking. You know, here there's all these Dutch... but Dutch people on board, you know, really panicking. And then we told the pilot, you put all the floor to the gases, get this thing out of here. And he said, I will do it. And instead of, we were still arrived on time, but we were really panicking the whole, from Kapsa, from Cape Verde's all the way to Washington. It was panicking, stricken. Because then it sunk in that one guy said to him, I read about, you know, because we don't get all the news like you do in Africa during that time. We had a lot of censoring and stuff going on.
Yes.
And he was a student doctor, and he said, I read about UFOs, and I wonder if it's not one of these damn things we've got in ourselves. You know, and then I said, what the hell is a UFO? It's unexplainable. You know, they try to explain to me what's going on. And
yes,
I don't want to sound like I'm dumb. Just don't get that kind of thing where I'm from.
No, I'm with you all the way. And actually, your reaction to it up until the point where you saw the bodies makes sense. Did this being stay apparently unconscious through the remainder of the trip?
It did. I don't think it survived it, the knock, because he broke his fingers. But he... then when we flew to Washington, we landed... unceremoniously, we landed very early in the morning. It was a very long flight. One person came dressed on as a colonel on board, the Hercules, and said, and started being very aggressive and started aggravating the crew and stuff, giving them orders and stuff like that. And then an American colonel. And I walked up to him and said, I'm a brigadier general. If you don't start giving me respect, I'm going to take this damn thing and dump it in the ocean. And next thing, I had guns pointing at me.
You did?
Yes.
All right. There's so much more to tell, General, but I've got a couple of questions I've got to get in.
Sure.
Number one, why have you decided to talk about this now?
I saw the television broadcast about the person by the name of Bob Lazar. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Bob Lazar is in Area 51... He made some drawings and stuff, and I saw it on television.
Yes, and he actually saw the craft in the corner of the hangar, the one that you, of course, have just described with a dent in it, right?
Yes, and that's the one we put a dent into and brought it down.
So seeing Bob Lazar talk about it made you decide to talk about it?
Yes, because there is other things, too, which... makes things sense about Area 51 in the past, which I've heard about, is the case which Area 51 denied that the base existed, and people got sick about that with the blisters and stuff on their bodies and stuff.
Yes.
Well, four of our people died that way.
My God. General, is there
similarities between the two cases?
Yes. General, is it true that you're in fear of your life for your life now?
Yes, I am.
Why and from whom?
I'm from the SA government.
The South African government?
Yes.
Why?
I remember the government was taken... the people I fought during the war is in power now. So it's not for me to explain that the easiest way. I'm not going to sleep in the same bed as the enemy, because the enemy is the one I fought during the war, and they're the ones already doing a lot of damage to people like me.
So even though you're in this country, the reach of the South African government could be a deadly one for you if you don't stop moving.
Yes, in such a way. I don't live in houses or anything like that. I don't sleep in one place one night longer than I have.
My God. I suppose one of your life's biggest regrets now is the shoot down of that craft.
I think so, because in many ways, if Bob Lazar, if I wish I could talk to him, I think that what I saw on television is unfair. I have also reasons to. I have a lot of other speakers I can talk about, but I don't think it'd be a wise thing to do. But Bob Lazar, they're saying that Bob Lazar never was in Area 51, and how can it be when he explains the same thing which I know of? It doesn't,
Okay, so in a way you're underlining Bob Lazar's story, and you're saying he had to have been there to have seen that.
That's correct. How else could he have done that? I mean, I don't think about his degrees in university and stuff. I know nothing about that. But I do know about this, that this ended up in Washington, D.C. We delivered it, and it was shipped from the Hercules directly onto a jet transport aircraft, which I don't know what it is, a cargo jet aircraft from the U.S., and it took off before we did, and we were told to stay on the ground for 40 minutes, and then we could leave.
All right, General, listen to me. I'm not sure where we'll go from here. I have the numbers, which I will keep private and secret. I appreciate your coming on the air tonight, and I just don't know what to say. Thank you for coming on.
At area code 775-727-1295. The first time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call Art at 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art Bell by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
That last hour, I think, was the radio equivalent of a shot heard around the world. That one's going to get repeated a few times. Good evening, everybody, from the high desert. I'm Art Bell. And coming up in a moment, Brendan Cook and Barbara Macbeth. Brendan Cook and Barbara Macbeth are both members of the Ghost Investigators Society, GIS. The Ghost Investigators Society is a, now this is really important, a non-profit organization dedicated to the investigation of ghosts. Not only do they conduct investigations, but they also instruct, assist, and educate anyone who believes that they may be experiencing ghostly phenomena, or those who are just simply curious. In an effort to educate the public about ghosts, the GIS hopes the EVPs, electronic voice phenomena, that you're about to hear will help demonstrate that the consciousness that you have and I have will survive after the body dies. That these voices may help to give a different perspective about life, death, and ghosts. And that, indeed, is what it will do. I have puzzled about these two people for the longest period of time, folks. And I always, you know, it's like, follow the money. Look for the holes. Look for the fraud. Look for the, you know, whatever. Because we're dealing here with the biggest question we have about life, and that's whether it abruptly stops. Ashes to ashes. And the big easy, the big black easy, just nothing but the big black veil. Well, that's a really important question. It would appear to me, as I've studied this with these two over the years, that this does prove that there is life after death. What it says about the nature of life after death is a very different question. And that's something I'm sure we'll be discussing as the evening goes on. And we'll sort of brief you in a moment on the care taken to make sure that there's no tomfoolery going around or on with what you're about to hear. I think it's extremely important we establish that. This is a non-profit group. They don't sell things. They don't, well, they don't collect any money for doing any of this. They don't write books. They don't do anything. As a matter of fact, about all I know they do is appear on this program. In a moment, the GIS. Brendan, Barbara, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
It's good to have you both. And you're up in, like, Utah or something, right?
Yes.
Okay. I think it's incredibly important at the beginning of the program to establish your bona fides. And to me, that means you're a nonprofit organization, right?
That's correct. We're nonprofit. We do not accept any money for anything that we do. We don't want money for anything that we do. We do this simply because we're obsessed with it.
You're not writing a book, making CDs for sale to the public,
no.
None of that stuff at all.
No, and believe me, I mean, and I'm sure you can guess this, that being on your program, we've had offers like that.
I can imagine, and I imagine resisting them must be very, very, very difficult.
Not really, because this was something that we agreed at the very beginning that we would not.
I know, but you're spending your own money on this, right?
Yes, we spend a lot of money on this, but you'd be exploiting the ghosts that are good enough to talk to us.
And you two is exactly why I keep having you back on the program, because I can't find a hole. I can't find a hole in all of this, your intentions, your motivations. I can't find a hole in any of it. And frankly, I don't think there's any bigger question for life on Earth right now than whether it's going to continue some form of what we call our consciousness, or whether it all just ends. Meaning, you know, without meaning, it would be kind of meaningless, wouldn't it, in a way, if it was just all a big blank at the end of it all?
It would be very meaningless.
It just doesn't make sense that that's the way it would work.
It's a continuous journey.
Can you give me and the audience, please, a little history of EVP? When did it begin? Who did it?
Well, EVP has been around, since the 50s. It originally started by a man who was actually not recording for voices, obviously, because this hadn't been heard of before.
Right.
He was actually recording bird calls in the woods.
Right.
And when he brought the tape back and was listening to these calls that he had just recorded, all of a sudden he started hearing these human voices, and he was alone by himself in the woods. And he at one time thought he had heard his father calling out to him. And it really, ever since then, has gone I mean, even farther to the point where we're at today, where, I mean, the equipment has advanced so much.
All right, when I first met you two and you first began appearing on the show, you only used tape recorders, you know, with audio tape. And the example you gave of Man in the Woods was of audio tape, right?
That's correct.
All right, and it was thought for a very long time, by you as well, I think, that audio tape, for some reason, because of the electromagnetic spectrum or something, was preferable, that these voices were imprinted using magnetic tape. And then, of course, the digital revolution has occurred over the years that you and I have been talking, and you began to take out, I guess, some digital machines, right?
That's correct. And that's, you know, that really brings up a good point, that we did at one time believe that this was all through electromagnetics. And that's why only audio tape would work. Digital, you know, in theory, wouldn't work if you were going by the electromagnetic theory. And it brings up the point that this is all theory. I mean, there is no way to know everything that's... how everything happened.
There are, however, certain ways to ensure purity. For example, when you were using tapes, you used only brand new tapes. Unwrap the wrapping. There couldn't have been a prior recording on it. Brand new tapes, right?
That's correct.
Or, conversely, you made sure that you were not near a radio station that might have somehow had RF getting into your equipment, producing what seemed to be voices or anything of that kind. In other words, every external influence has been dealt with and ruled out, correct?
That's correct. In fact, let me give you a case that we did. It was at a house that the people were experiencing children. They were seeing children in their home, and they had no children. And we went, conducted, I believe, two investigations, and would bring the tapes home. And when we listened to the tapes, we started hearing what could only be described as radio broadcasts.
It was definitely radio.
Yeah, I mean, it just sounded nothing like any of the other EVP that we'd recorded.
Uh-huh.
Well, after researching the location of the house and researching what is around the location, we found that directly behind this house was a drive-in theater.
Oh, really?
And they were actually sending out the audio from the movie on a radio frequency.
That's right. Drive-ins, toward the end of their life, there aren't many of them left, began doing that so you could turn on your radio in the car and you didn't have that rattly little speaker and you could listen to the audio on your car radio. It was pretty unique. And that's what it was?
Yeah. And I mean, we actually started hearing clips of movies coming into our recorders. So
the whole thing had to be, you had to just rule out anything that you got.
Got it. But in your investigations, and you have been into countless cemeteries, let's see, prisons, you visit all kinds of cheery little locations, right?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
And you, however, maintain that it's not necessary to go to a place of death to record the sounds of the dead.
That's correct. And I've had many people tell me about experiences where they have been taping for practice for singing or at different occasions, and they've picked up voices that they can't explain.
Doesn't it actually go all the way back to, I'm trying to think, was it Alexander Graham?
Thomas Edison.
Thomas Edison, who thought that it might be a way to converse with the dead.
Yes.
That's correct.
And he was working on a machine to do that at the time of his death.
Was he at the time of his death, really?
Yes.
Do you have any idea, either one of you, the nature of that machine?
We really don't.
His family wasn't too...
hot on the subject?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't know if any kind of notes or anything have... made it,
Yes, I just wonder what his technical theory would have been. He would have been designing something specifically to hear the other side, and it would have been sure interesting to know what he had in mind.
Yes, it would have been, but he felt like it was very possible to be able to communicate if you had the correct device.
All right, the two of you. Now, we're about to hear recordings from the other side tonight. Do either one of you have any doubt whatsoever that what you're hearing is from the other side?
No.
No.
I don't at all.
How many years
we
have you...
We don't present anything that we feel might... on our website or on your program, we don't present anything that we feel might even possibly be something else.
How many years have it... Well, it's not just the two of you. How many are in GIS? It's small.
There's five of us.
Five, that's right. How long have you been doing this?
Six. The group itself has been together 6 years now. Yeah, actually, we're going on to our seventh year.
On in... Wow, that's a long time.
And we still love each other.
Yeah. We're still definitely like family.
Well, okay. Were you two the founding members, or...?
No. No. There was the four members at the beginning. When we met, we just clicked, and then... about a year and a half later, we met Barry, and he was always interested in it, and we were very compatible with him. And
okay. Are others always trying to join your group now?
Yes, all the time.
Yes, they are.
And how do you handle that?
We just don't take membership. We go out.
Why not?
It causes too much problems.
Yes, I'm sure.
You can't do an investigation with a lot of people. I mean, it can't even be serious. There's just too much talking. You can't make people be quiet.
Right. Understood. All right. Even though you claim that these voices can be gathered from any place, really, you do tend to go to the graveyards and the prisons and the very dark places, the haunted mansions. Why?
Well, a lot of times those are the locations that contact us, or locations that people have told us about.
So they are hotspots?
In a way, yeah, I believe they are. But also, like Barbara said, I mean, there can be places you wouldn't even associate with a ghost that could just as easily be haunted.
Or I guess cold spots.
Yeah.
Actually. All right, very briefly, I would like to know from each of you what you... think you know after hearing years of these EVPs. Don't worry, folks, we're about playing, but I want to know what each of you thinks about the nature of the other side, what it's like over there, based on what you've heard over the years. What do you think the other side is like?
I think the realm that ghosts are in, I feel like most of them are very tormented mentally. They're not happy.
Well, that sounds like fun.
But I don't believe that everyone is a ghost. A ghost is really a person that's lived and died and is stuck still in our realm. Although I don't think that the spirit world is that far from us anyway. But I think the realm that the ghosts are in is not to where they should be.
So, Barbara, in other words, you're saying they haven't made the whole journey. They're in some sort of Netherland.
Right, and they're able somehow to still communicate with us.
Got it. Brendan?
Well, I think generally I believe the same thing Barbara does. I believe that, you know, ghosts are not the only thing. I do believe there's something past, you know, somebody becoming a ghost. And like
right.
Barbara said, I don't believe everybody becomes one.
Right.
And I think
do you agree they're tortured souls? That's a pretty dramatic phrase.
I don't know if I'd say tortured. I think in a way they may be tortured, especially if, you know, what's happening is they're not realizing that they've passed on. And, I mean, in a way, that's mentally, that's torture.
There is
sit there and not be able to interact with your loved ones.
Sure.
And figure out why, you know,
sure.
why you can't do that.
There is the concept of purgatory. And then there's also the fact that many don't seem to be aware, or at least for some period of time, that they're dead.
That's right. I think many of them have unresolved issues. And we've had a lot of, well, not a lot, but there's people that have kind of put us down for not claiming to know things that we should know.
Yeah.
But you cannot know about the unknown. There is no way to know.
That's fair. I mean, sure, of course that's fair. You can't answer all the questions, nor are you here to.
No.
But I understand that people tend to demand that of you.
Yes, and, you know, there's it wouldn't be unknown if we knew.
Right. Have you ever had any communication that would indicate that there is a further trip, that there is a place to go beyond where these poor creatures appear to be?
I really don't think that we have. I mean, we certainly haven't received a voice saying, you know, I'm going to Jesus after this, or anything like that.
In fact, how many religious references have you even heard in all the EVPs?
I think the closest thing we've heard is reference to the light.
Yeah.
You know, come enjoy the light, or
I'm
in the light, or...
The light. Yes, of course, the light. The light mentioned by so many who have had NDEs, right?
Yes. And we've you know, recorded voices that refer to the light.
Even though I know you two try to be upbeat about it, a lot of what you have played has seemed sad or tortured or frightening or scary in some way. And so I can understand that a lot of people listening, contemplating their own mortality, might not like what they hear.
Well, I have always told people, try to resolve the issues that you have in this life, because it's not something that you're going to get rid of after you pass on.
Do the two of you, I'm sure you've discussed this, do the two of you, if you do pass on, are you going to make an attempt to communicate with the group? Is there some sort of pact that your group has made, along with your secret handshake and stuff?
I would definitely try.
Have you actually even made up phrases or things that you might try to communicate, or how far have you gone with that?
Barbara, I believe, has just said that she would smack us if she if she saw us.
A good strong tap on the shoulder.
Have any of your group passed on yet?
No,
they're all still alive.
Yes.
And you plan on continuing to do this for years yet to come? You think the rest of your lives, or what?
Oh, yeah.
I will always, I've always been involved with this in some way, as far back as I can remember, and I will always want to be involved in it somehow up until I die, and even after that.
And even after that. if given a choice to proceed straight to go without passing whatever zone we're about to hear from, would you do that, or do you want to take the ghostly route for a little while to try for the communications?
I would want to take the ghostly route.
Of course,
definitely.
You would.
Oh, really?
Oh, yes.
Oh,
I think it would be a learning continuation of learning.
Well, I guess it would be. All right, when we come back, we're going to cross over electronically, and what you're going to hear, well, I don't know. It might scare you. It might give you hope. No, it's more likely to scare you. So if you can't handle this kind of thing, you might want to switch off the radio about now.
Want to time travel? Go back to past shows on Streamlink. Sign up online at coasttocoastam.com.
Thank you.
talk with Art Bell, call the Wildcard Line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
It is. Weekend version. Good morning, everybody, or at least the majority of you at any rate. I am Art Bell. In a moment, we're going to take a trip, actually, to the other side. The voices you're about to hear, indeed, come from the other side. The other side of what? Well, I don't know. Present consciousness. These programs take a particularly heavy toll on the truck drivers out there driving through the very dark night to deliver the goods and services we need across this country. And I do understand that. Hearing these voices wafting their way through the ether in the middle of the night is a little unnerving. By the way, you two, Michael in Danuba, California says, "Hey, Mr. Bell, I'm 17 years old tomorrow, you know, and I've listened to you for 4 years. I never thought that I'd go through something that your callers talk about on the show. 2 days ago, I left a recorder on my bed to see what would happen. Sure enough, I got an EVP. It simply said, dream on, kid." Maybe there's... All right, the sentence setting, where are these recordings, the first group that we're going to hear, where were they done?
They were done in various cemeteries, about the first five. Private residences, prisons.
Oh, this
mausoleums.
Is a mausoleum. Oh, so we get the great grand tour tonight, huh?
Yes.
All right, let's do it. Number one is what?
We were in a northern Utah cemetery, and we believe that this voice might be speaking Indian. The interesting thing about this area that we were in, when the settlers first settled this little town, they had built a stone wall around the town to protect themselves from the Indians that were there.
Mm-hmm.
And we believe it sounds to us like an Indian voice, but you're going to hear Brendan in the background say, "Did you get it?" And then this Indian voice replies. If anybody can understand what it's saying, we would like you to tell us what it is.
Here we go.
Get it?
Okay, that sounds like a young female voice to me.
Yes.
Oh, you agree?
Yes.
And I'm not sure I could clearly hear Brennan say, "Did you get it?" And what, Brennan, what did you mean by that? Were you referring to anything to do with the voice?
No, I wasn't. Actually, I was, Jenny was the one that recorded that voice, and I was quite a ways away from her, probably 40, 50 feet away from her, talking to Barbara, and I think I was asking her if she got her camera.
Uh-huh.
And, I mean, that was really the only context with that voice, was me in the background saying, "Did you get it?"
Well, I certainly can't make out what's being said, so let's listen one more time. Here it is. Well, that's hard. Can anybody translate? All right, well, there it is. Maybe somebody in the audience will be able to translate that for us.
The Indians that were in that area at the time were the Ute Indians. I don't know if the dialect is that much different from other tribes, but it sounds like Indian language to me.
Maybe we'll get some help. In fact, let me give out my email address for the remainder of the program. It's ArtBell at mindspring.com. That's A-R-T-B-E-L-L at mindspring.com or ArtBell at AOL.com. You can reach me with email at either one of those. And by the way, you two, you have a website and probably hundreds or even thousands of electronic voice phenomena recordings for people to listen to on your website, correct?
We do, and I'm glad you brought that up.
Okay, we've got it linked on our website, coastcoastam.com, but I presume you, I mean, go ahead and give out your URL.
Well, the URL is ghostpix, that's ghostpix.com. Now, the reason I'm glad you brought that up is on the last show we did with you, we were talking about how our bandwidth for that month was going to be horrible.
Yeah.
Because of doing your show, obviously.
And it was.
That's right.
We got a horrendous bill from it.
Yeah.
But thanks to your show, we had a wonderful man contact us named Jamie Morgan, and he actually provided us with a server.
Oh, really? And bandwidth?
And more bandwidth than we could ever ask for. So we are now able to present pretty much as many voices and as many videos as we want. So really, I'd like to test that tonight and have as many people hit that site as they can.
All right. That's www.ghostpix.com, ghostpix.com, right?
That's correct.
Very good. All right, you guys, let's rock and roll and get to something that we can understand here.
All right.
Number two.
Now this one, this was also recorded by Jenny, and this was recorded in the same cemetery as the previous voice.
Mm.
Now the interesting thing about this is we had been going to the cemetery for the last 3-4 years easy, and every once in a while we would notice that a truck would drive in and park in the same spot of the cemetery every single night.
Mm-hmm.
It was always in the same spot. He would sit there for about 45 minutes, and then he would drive off.
Mm-hmm.
Well, one night, we were actually parked in his spot, and he had started to come in, and we were, we'd start talking amongst each other, saying, we better move. And Barbara had decided to go over and talk to him. And he had explained to Barbara that the reason he had been parking there was his wife and son are buried in this spot.
Yes.
And he would sit there and spend time with them. Well, this clip, you hear Jenny explaining to another girl that was with us. She says there was one time we came in here, and there was a truck parked up there, and he just had his car on the whole time. This was obviously before we knew why he was coming in there.
Sure.
And after this, it sounds like almost a younger voice saying, "It's Daddy's car."
Oh. All right, here we go.
So one time I came here, there was a truck parked up there, and he just had his car on the whole time.
It's Daddy's car. It does sound like that's what's being said, and it certainly is a very young voice, huh?
Yes.
Okay. Well, this, of course, begs the question of whether we remain near the site of our physical body's death, which is not a very entertaining prospect for me, and I'm sure many others. I mean, if you're 6 feet down, you expect to be, 6 miles up, not there at the site of your physical internment.
Well, and that's true, but, in the case of this last voice...
Yes.
If it is his child, the child would be staying there because he knows his father is going to be coming back there.
To visit the graves. Yeah, well, it's a good point. Listen one more time.
One time we came here, there was a truck parked up there, and he just had his car on the whole time.
Yeah, it's Daddy's car. That's what it seems to say. Well, you make a good point. It could just be that whoever is the ghost knows that Daddy's going to be there and has been there every day, and so maybe that's just why. Maybe it's the living that are choosing the place, not not the ghosts.
That's certainly a good point.
I hope that's a good point. all right. I keep trying to derive myself, you see, some idea of what I think the other side is like based on what I'm hearing here, and I'm not always encouraged. All right, number three.
On this one, we were in a cemetery, and the mosquitoes were pretty bad. I was trying to get Brendan to use some bug spray. You're going to hear Brendan say, no, thank you. And I say, just do your neck and shoulder and arms. And this voice comes in, and it's, we believe it says, everybody here is the same.
Everybody here is the same. Okay, here we go. Okay, everybody here is the same. I wonder what they mean by that. Bug bitten or dead?
I don't know. A lot of times when they speak, it doesn't make sense to us on what we are saying and what they say. It's like it's not related to what we're saying.
What percentage of the time in the EVPs does what's said appear to be responding in some way to your presence?
I'd say a big majority of them.
A big majority?
Respond to what we're talking about.
It's hard to say, because in a way, if you really think about it, some of these voices could be responding to what we're saying. And then you could look at it another way and go, well, no, that really doesn't have anything to do with
it. How many unmistakably responsive things do you hear? I mean, the human brain does try to make sense out of chaos. And if a remark is made that doesn't seem to make sense on the face of it, you will search for something that will make it make sense, something you said or might have been interpreted. So that's what our brains try and do. I just wonder how many unmistakable times something has absolutely responded to you. There can be no mistake about
it. I'd say over half of them do.
Oh, that's a lot. All right, onward. Number four, I think, yes.
All right. Well, while we were in a cemetery, Barbara was talking to the rest of the group about a house that we had done. And she, while we were investigating this house, she had walked into the kitchen, and on this clip, you're going to hear her say, and I walked into the kitchen and said, is there something that we can do to help you?
Mm-hmm.
And ever since then, she had had things happening in her home, Barbara has, and she had felt almost like something had followed her. But after she says this on this clip, after Barbara says this, you hear a girl say, they followed you.
They followed you. All right, here we go.
And I walk in the kitchen, I said, is there something that we can do to help you? They followed me. They followed me. They followed me.
Okay, see, that would way creep me out. They followed you. That was an unmistakable voice, and it very clearly said they followed you.
Yes.
This is not good. Now, I remember you saying on previous broadcasts that when you leave cemeteries and places of death and misery like prisons, that you always suggest to any spirits there that they not follow you, right?
Yes.
Give a very strong admonition of some sort.
Yes, we tell them that we're, they're not invited to come with us. And,
yes.
And they need to stay where they're at and not follow us.
But this,
we have had occasions where we believe that they have. And I think a lot of it's out of curiosity.
And this was one of them.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Here it is again.
And I walk in the kitchen, I said, is there something that we can do to help you? Just follow me. Just follow me. Just follow me.
They followed you. Were there repercussions following that admission?
No, not really. I don't take them as repercussions on events that we experience. My husband does, but...
Yeah, I suppose, again, the brain, especially with the work you kind of, you two do, would sort of try to make sense of different events in your life that might be otherwise puzzling?
Yes, we've had some pretty incredible things happen in the house but we know that this house that we're living in right now has activity in it. I didn't know it at the time when we moved in, but there have been things that have happened that there's no other explanation that have been witnessed by more than just me and my husband.
Well, I think pretty much everybody in the group has witnessed something in this house.
Really? Now, is it your view that whatever it is that's in your house now followed you?
No, I think there was something here when we moved in.
Oh, you do?
Yes.
But this was a young lady on the other side saying they followed you.
Yes, and at that time, we lived in a different home. And there was things that happened in that home after the investigation of that house.
How many times have the two of you seen spirits as well as heard them?
I've been privileged on probably three occasions that I can think of offhand where I've actually seen something.
Brandon?
And with me, it would probably be two. And one of those, I could, if I really tried, maybe rationalize it as a shadow. But I think that'd be stretching it quite a bit.
All right. Let's try and get one more in here. Number five.
On this one, we believe that this is another Indian voice. It was in that same cemetery. You're going to hear Jenny say, "Ah, here comes somebody else." There was a car that started pulling into the cemetery, and we were sitting in our car, and she recorded this voice.
And it says, do you know what?
We have no idea what it says, and here's another one. If anyone can understand what it's saying, it sounds like Indian language to us.
Okay, here we go.
Well, here comes somebody else.
Well, that's good. That's going to be very, very hard for somebody. But perhaps some sort of Indian language.
Well, here comes somebody else.
All right, well, there it is. If anybody is able to translate it. One of the questions I get frequently from people who write me emails or blasts about this is, do you get other languages? And obviously the answer is yes.
Yes, we have.
I think we've got some Spanish and German also on the website.
I'm not sure how productive it would be for doing on this program, but the answer is you do get it, and in what kind of proportion? How is it a frequent thing or very?
No, it really isn't, and I think a lot of that has to do with the nature of the places that we go. We're not going to a lot of places, especially. I mean, we're not going any places outside of the country.
Well, that certainly would be a worthwhile experiment, even if you could only get to Mexico. For example, to get to a Mexican graveyard and then see if 98% of what you receive is Spanish.
Well, and there are other people in other countries that are doing this, and they are getting voices in their native tongue.
That itself is really worthwhile. So you're telling me EVP research is going on all over the world, right?
Oh, that's correct. Yes, definitely. In fact, there's a lot of really decent research going out of Germany.
Germany.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, then people should know it's not just y'all. This is going on all over the world. Electronic voice phenomena is what it's called. From the high desert in the middle of the night, I'm Art Bell.
On the crest of a wave, it's like magic.
subscribe to the After Dark newsletter and reserve your free CD of Art Bell and the late father Malachi Martins. 888-727-5505. To talk with Art Bell, call the Wildcard line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5. And dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
Brendan Cook and Barbara Macbeth, the GIS, the Ghost Investigators Society, are here. They do recordings from the other side, mostly graveyards, prisons, that sort of thing, by their choice. That's where they go, and they definitely get them. We've had a couple of Indian voices, and I can't make heads or tails of it, but maybe one of you out there will. In the meantime, we're about to get into some voices that you will be able to understand. Voices not from this side. I think it's very important that all of you know over the years, we have encouraged the audience to do this themselves, to take tape recorders or then later some sort of digital recording device into cemeteries, into different areas where you think there might be a presence, and try it yourself. And I've got to tell you, personal, honest observation here, that I don't know, you know, there's millions of you out there, right? So a portion of 1% is going to do it. You know, they're going to try it themselves. And I'm telling you, I have had, over the years, hundreds and hundreds of emails from people who have tried it and it worked. They got EVPs and scared the hell out of themselves. And I'm sure that you two get emails just like that, don't you?
Oh, of course.
Yes.
In fact, the last voice we're going to play on your show tonight is a voice that was sent in from a lady who had started doing this trying to prove us wrong.
There you are. Yes, I know.
Just so full of it. So.
I know. And then, boom, it happens to them, and they're writing to me saying, oh, my God, Art, I'm sorry. I'm really sorry about the things I said in the previous email. They took a recorder and went out. Now, just very quickly, if somebody wants to go out and try this themselves, you two, what would be your favorite equipment to take? What?
I think that would vary between Barbara and I, because I would prefer any of the digital equipment now.
Okay.
And Barbara still enjoys the analog, because she's used to it.
Oh, a schism.
I don't change that easy. I think I'm too old to change.
Oh, this is a serious schism in the GIS, actually, because, you know, the newer...
I really
newer...
like having the tapes, though, to be able to have them as a documentation of the investigation.
But there's so much tape noise.
Yeah. I know there
hiss,
is.
You know, the hiss on tapes, and if it comes through digital as well, well, there's it's pretty obvious. When you get a digital recording, some of these are going to be digital coming up, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
Well, they'll knock you right over. They're clear. So I'd be with you on this one, Brendan.
Yeah. And I'm afraid I wouldn't ever be able to use it. I I'm really intimidated by some of the technology anymore.
All right. Number six.
Okay. Well, this one, I'm sure you remember, I believe, the last show we did with you or the show before that, we played some voices from a mortician's house.
Oh, yes, I remember.
Well, the next, five or six voices coming up are from the mortician's house again.
Wonderful.
From another investigation that we did there.
This is a mortician who agreed to allow you in.
He invited us there.
He did. His new wife had been seeing a small boy in their home. They did have a child who was a small boy, but they would see a child in their home when their son was gone.
Uh-huh.
And they seemed to notice that this ghost child would stay around their young boy's room. So, needless to say, it kind of bothered them a little bit.
Yeah, would bother me. Time for a new occupation. Anyway, number six.
All right, well, on this one, Barbara, you're going to hear Barbara talking, and she's saying, I might want to put this up on the stairs. And she's trying to figure out where to put a wireless infrared camera.
Right.
So we can monitor the upstairs area.
Right.
And you hear her say, I might want to put this up on the stairs. And then a woman's voice comes in that's clearly not Barbara. And it sounds to us like she's saying, to Evanston, move up there.
Huh. Okay.
I might want to put this up on the stairs.
Yep. That's pretty good. I hear the same thing, and I don't think it's just because you suggested it to me, to Evanston, move up there. Is what it says. Any idea what she's referring to at all?
Not a clue.
Not a clue.
Other than move up there, maybe move up the stairs.
Okay, what do you do to these recordings, Brennan? In what way do you clarify? Because I notice when we get the repeat, it's a little clearer, a little louder.
That's correct. For the most part, the very first recording that you hear with the actual context of the investigator,
yes,
we try to leave that alone. We may amplify it a little bit, but other than that, we try to leave it alone.
Got it.
The last two clips that you hear that's just the voice, we will amplify that, and if it's an analog tape, do a hiss reduction on it.
Right.
But other than that, I mean, we don't slow them down. We don't do anything like that.
One more time.
I might want to put this up on the stairs.
Oh, well. That is very odd, and it's very female, and but not necessarily related at all to what you were saying or doing or anything else, right?
Correct.
It must make you wonder sometimes if you're not just sort of tapping in on a conversation on the other side, some ongoing conversation, some little piece of it somehow comes wafting through.
And sometimes it definitely seems like that.
Yeah.
There's sometimes we have recorded two separate voices that almost sound like they're interacting with each other. And what's really odd about some of them is sometimes the voices seem to be interacting with each other, but they're talking about us.
Hmm.
One case I can remember is two male voices saying, shh, they're coming.
Really? Okay. That was shh, right?
Yes.
That's correct, yes.
Yes. Number seven.
All right. On this one, Brendan and the gentleman of the house were standing there looking at the monitor that the infrared camera goes to.
Oh, yes.
And all of a sudden, it just went...
It died.
Died, you know, for no reason. And Brendan, you'll hear Brendan say, that was weird. And the man says, yeah. And then Brendan says that it would have just gone out suddenly. You didn't touch it, right? And the guy says, uh-uh. And Brendan goes, huh? And it sounds like a child say, Lori pet the ectoplasm. And it's not ectoplasm, it's echoplasm.
Lori pet the ectoplasm. All right, let's see if we hear that.
That was weird. Yeah.
It would have just gone out suddenly. You didn't touch it, right?
Uh-uh.
Huh.
Oh, see, now that's pretty good. I like that one. Lori pet the ecoplasm. Maybe ecoplasms are little creatures that run around on the other side.
I have no idea.
Now, here's an interesting thing about this voice.
Yeah.
Is if you remember the last show we did with you where we played some voices from this man's house.
Yes.
I recorded a child's voice after I'd seen him in the mirror. Now, that voice is up on the website. If you play these two voices side by side.
Think they're the same?
It sounds exactly the same.
How interesting. One more time with feeling.
That was weird.
Yeah.
It would have just gone out suddenly. You didn't touch it, right?
Uh-uh.
Huh.
The power of suggestion. Now, you know, you've told me that that should sound like Lori pet the ecoplasm, but it does. It, you know, I wonder if I would have heard that without your suggestion. It sure, it sounds like Lori pet the ecoplasm. I don't know, sometimes, and that's the other thing that I get fast blasted and emailed about, that, you know, there is the power of suggestion here that you're telling people what they will hear based on what you think it said. And I know you sit around as kind of a committee and decide what it is that was said, but I'm not sure how strong the power of suggestion is.
Oh, I believe it is pretty strong, because we have done this, and, you know, we've thought it, we were so sure that it said this certain thing, and then we'll play it at, like, a lecture that we do.
Yes.
And we'll get 10 or 15 people coming up to us going, no, says this. I know for a fact it says this.
Right.
And then sure enough, we'll go back and listen to it, and we can hear that.
Well, I really do hear Lori pet the ecoplasm. I'm just not sure how strong the power of suggestion is. On occasion, we should just play one without, I suppose, telling them what you think it says, and let the audience come up with what they think it says.
Yeah.
But that's all right. For now, we'll just move on. We're still in the mortician's house?
Yeah, that's correct. And in this clip, now this one, Barbara loves this one for some reason. On this clip, Barbara is moving the infrared camera again, and she's talking to Roger. You'll hear on this clip Barbara say, right there, and Roger says, yeah, and Barbara says, okay. And then right after this, right after that exchange, you will hear like an old haggish woman. It sounds like she says, tell your friend to run.
Really? All right, here we go.
There? No.
Okay. Hey, fast and fast. Hey, fast and fast. Hey, fast and fast.
Sounds like Evelyn Paglini. She's not an old hag, but she is the witch's witch, and she's got quite the voice. It does sound a little like Evelyn. Let's try it one more time. This is a pretty good one. I feel like running myself, so it's really good.
No. Okay.
God. Oh, my God, that's creepy. That's really creepy. And that's what I said. I'm sure you've had emails from these guys, but these poor lot, thousands of truckers at this time of the night are crisscrossing the interstates of the United States, and we covered just about every inch of it, right? And they're hearing this stuff in the middle of the night. And I'll tell you what, this will creep you out. It will seriously creep you out. It will also keep you awake.
Well, and you know, I was actually surprised how many truckers do listen to this show. There was one time we were at a truck stop in Wyoming.
Oh.
Heading to the Rollins prison.
Yes.
And we were sitting there eating breakfast, and we had our GIS shirts on, and this guy comes up to us and goes, "Oh my God, you guys really do exist."
Uh-huh.
And we were like, "Well,
yeah,
we definitely do exist."
Well, yeah. Yes, right. I really do know there's a high percentage of truckers that listen, and this particular show probably would of many of them be the very hardest to listen to in the dark in the middle of the night out in the middle of Wyoming or something.
We've had some of them email us and tell us that.
Now, I know that for a while you were experimenting with a recorder that would give you immediate results. In other words, a gentleman put together a device for you that I had been suggesting that would record and play in a delayed fashion, you know, a few seconds, and you'd be able to actually on-site hear what was said. Where is that gone? Are you not using that anymore, or do you still use it?
We still are using it.
Okay.
The only problem has been is we have to modify the tapes that we use for it. So obviously, for one, it's not digital, so it's not as clear as some of the recordings we can do now.
Yes.
And also, because of having to modify the tapes, we're running into problems where there's tape lag and, you know, voices being slowed down or speeded up. And, I mean, it's so hard to distinguish between any legitimate EVP.
Gotcha.
We've done about like
we're on our fifth prototype of it right now.
Okay, yeah. Might I suggest, Brendan, that you move into the digital world with this concept. Digital delays now are fairly common. We're using one as you and I talk right now that delays what we're saying by 6 seconds in case Janet runs in the room or something, you know? And so that could be done with what you're doing as well.
It could. And that would certainly be something that we would love to do. The only problem, as I'm sure you've mentioned before, and we've mentioned before, is we fund ourselves. So to yes. be able to actually purchase some of this equipment takes quite a bit of time for us.
Gotcha. I've gotcha. So you're in such a position because, you know, you really could be making a lot of money with this. I mean, you could write books, obviously. You could publish CDs. You could probably do a lot of things. One thing you can do is, for example, go on television. Have you done TV after doing this radio program? Have you been contacted by...
We have been contacted by a few people. It's nothing that has been worked out or finalized on anything.
Right.
I mean, there's some things that are still kind of floating out there, and
sure.
eventually something may happen with it.
Sure.
But, I mean, it's certainly something that we would look into. I don't know about as far as being paid for it. Maybe, you know, in exchange for equipment or...
There you go.
...wanting to go to investigations, travel to places to do investigations, things like that.
Well, yes, I do think it is important that you keep your 503C status intact, whatever it is, you know, so that people... keep a healthy respect for what you're doing. Otherwise, it'll be too easy to say...
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
Yeah, you know that already. Okay.
I mean, there is no way we would accept money for doing this.
Okay.
I mean, it's just, it's not kosher, really.
Number nine.
On this one, this was recorded shortly after the Tell Your Friend to Run. Brendan had stepped outside, and you're going to hear the wind blowing. He had stepped outside the house to go to the car to get some equipment. And it's a different woman's voice, but she says to him, please run.
Please run. So, please run. Okay. Well, 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 well. Now, that's very interesting because right after you've had one that said, tell your friend to run, which is bad enough, you have, through the wind, this female voice coming saying, please run. One more time. Now, if you had had that digital device that I was just talking about, and you had actually heard, tell your friend to run, and then please run, maybe there'd be a downside to that whole idea, because you'd probably run.
Yeah, we probably wouldn't have seen Brendan the rest of the night.
Yeah, okay. No, actually, I mean, if we were to hear that, and, you know, we have got to the point with the real-time recorder that we have been using that we have heard things in real time. And I found it so amazing to be able to hear them and actually respond to it. And
you've
say,
been told,
you know,
to,
I just heard you.
Yeah, you've been told to get the hell out, right?
Yeah, and I actually, there was another one that I obviously I'm not going to repeat on the air, but it had told me something pretty horrible after I had said I heard you.
Right. So there's even a little of that over on the other side, eh?
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
In fact, how much of that is there? Bad language.
You know, I'm surprised that we haven't received more than we have. I wouldn't say it's more than 10%.
10% bad language.
I don't even think it's that much.
Yeah.
Well, that's much better than the average population.
Yes, it is.
All right, you two, hold on. The GIS with us this night. Moon's pretty bright out there from the high desert. This is Coast to Coast AM.
Can't believe what you're hearing? Listen to it again when you sign up for StreamLink at www.coasttocoastam.com. It's only 15 cents a day.
Investigators Society, tomorrow night, same time, same station, Major Ed Dames. Couple of fast blasts. One asking, how do you two know that you're not being influenced by evil entities or evil or Luciferian things that want you to believe something and this is all a big scam on y'all?
Well, first of all, in the years that we've been doing this, we've never had anything happen. I mean, nothing that would harm us.
So far?
Well, yeah, so far, but I mean, we've been doing this for 6 years, and longer than that, but as a group for 6 years, and not one thing has happened.
In fact, so, Jason in Columbus, Ohio, says, hey, Art, EVP is very real. I personally have gotten results while investigating haunted locations with the Ohio Exploration Society. They've got a website here. I was a total skeptic until I started getting results myself on tape.
Oh, and that's, you wouldn't believe how many people
well, I would.
That exact thing.
Yes, I would.
Well, you probably would.
I get the emails. And that's what people have to understand, that they're not listening to a sideshow, a freak show here. This is something you can do and prove to yourself.
And you don't have to do it at nighttime by yourself. Some of our best EVPs have been picked up in broad daylight. So people that are leery about doing it in the dark, you know, by themselves out in a cemetery, they can take stroll through a cemetery at noon and
see, I've got to be honest with you, I'm one of those people. I really wouldn't go strolling into a cemetery late at night in the dark by myself. No.
And you really shouldn't go by yourself. You should have at least another person with you because the conversation between the two will likely generate EVP if there is a presence there.
Here comes another one, number 10.
All right. Now this is also back in the mortician's house. And Barbara was asking me, you'll hear her say, go in that room and see what type of reading you pick up in that office at the end of the hall. And she was asking me to go in there with a thermal scanner.
I was about to ask.
And I went in there, and after she says this, as I'm walking away into that room, you hear what sounds like a child's voice saying, I think I'll leave.
All right, here we go.
So go in that room and see what kind of a room you picked up in that office at the end of the hall.
Hey,
in a sort of a in-between land, when we're ghosts, and not necessarily a pleasant reward it is, then to hear children there is just doesn't seem right. And
no, and we record so many children, it's just staggering.
Yes.
And we never allow children to be at an investigation with us.
Well, I can fully understand that. One more time.
So go in that room and see what kind of a room you picked up in that office that's in the hall.
Child. It's a child.
Hey, Bobby.
A young child. There's no question about it. So, you two have done a lot more thinking about all of this than certainly most of us have. Why do you think we're hearing so many young voices?
Me personally, I almost wonder if children, because they don't have a concept of death. I mean, obviously, they don't understand it. It doesn't make sense to them. So, if they die young, that is such a shock, and it's something I don't know if maybe they can't deal with.
Mm.
I don't think they have an understanding of what's happened to them. They might not even realize that something has happened to them.
Boy, that's disturbing. It is just disturbing. What percentage of children do you record, do you think?
I think actually it could be over half.
That's a lot. Over half. That's really a lot.
If you go on our website and just count how many children's voices are on there, I think that's a good majority of the voices is children.
Over half. That's actually, you hadn't told me that before. I didn't realize it was that many. That's quite concerning.
Yes, it is. And we've even recorded them, what sounds like children, in prisons.
Mm-hmm.
In areas that you wouldn't even think a child ghost would be.
No, indeed not. Well, any conclusions or just the unknown?
Just part of the unknown.
Part of the unknown. You see, that's another thing I like about you all. You don't really come to conclusions about all these big questions because you don't know and you're not afraid to say so. That's refreshing.
There's nothing to be ashamed of saying you don't know.
And you really can't. I mean, in fact, I think you really need to be careful of anybody that could say without a doubt, this is what this is. I mean, especially dealing with this. Because that, I mean, they're either one, looking for money, or two, looking to steal something from you.
Yeah, right. All the answers.
Yeah.
We don't have.
There's a lot of those out there.
I know. I interviewed many of them, actually. Number 11.
We're going to the Moz. We're going to the mausoleum.
Oh, now to the mausoleum, huh?
In this one, Brendan was down in the basement at a far end of a mausoleum, and he heard a noise, and he thought it was Roger. The interesting thing is the noise that he heard was not recorded on the recorder. When he was listening to it, he didn't hear that noise. But you hear him responding, calling to Roger, who he thought was there. He says, "Roger, Roger," and then this voice comes in, and it says, "I need help."
All right, let's take a listen.
Roger? Roger?
What? I'm not getting that. I need help. I'm going to listen to that again because I'm not making that out. I don't hear that. What am I missing?
She sounds like she's really struggling to get those words out to me.
Is it? It is your experience, isn't it? That it is an apparent struggle for them to get this imprinted on your machines. Is that correct?
Oh,
on some of them, it sounds like they really struggle.
And you can hear that in a lot of the voices we present on the website and on your show. In fact, Jenny had mentioned that it's almost like if you've ever heard somebody who's deaf trying to talk, that's almost what it sounds like, that they can't hear themselves when they're talking.
Interesting analogy.
It really is.
Okay, I'm going to listen to this one more time because I really couldn't make out. I need help. Let's try it again.
Roger.
You know, maybe I did. I was forcing myself to hear it. There was a great pause in there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, there is.
She's pausing between each word.
Yeah, the help part at the very end. I all of a sudden I could start hearing that. Isn't that interesting? One last time, listen to the end.
Roger.
The help at the end.
Roger.
I need, and then pause. Help. Listen. How do you sit around a table, the whole bunch of you, and review these and trying to come to a consensus, or how do you decide finally what to put down?
Sometimes we don't ever agree on what. It's almost like we have to flip a coin on.
Yeah, for example, last night, posting some new EVP on the website.
Yes.
There was one voice that Barbara just swore up and down that this is what she heard, and no matter how many times I listened to it, I could not
hear that.
Hear it whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, there are times like that where you just...
Where the five of us don't hear the same thing.
But there's other times that it's just so blatantly clear.
That's interesting. So it's even within your own group, do you get the power of suggestion? In other words, the first person saying something is the person who gets the consensus, usually?
No. Actually, sometimes it's the second person or the third person.
Fascinating.
And then there's other times that none of us hear what the other hears. And as hard as we try, we can't. I mean, there's been times I cannot hear at all what the others are saying.
What is it you guys want to do from all this? I mean, what do I mean by that? I mean, you're not taking money. You're not seeking fame, fortune. So what keeps driving you? What do you want to know? What do you want to do?
Everything is different. Every time we go out, anything that happens, it's always a new experience. There's never been the same thing happen, and it's a continual learning thing.
Well, and you know, like I said at the beginning of the show, we're obsessed with it. This is something we enjoy doing, and I think ultimately all of our goals is to go to the most haunted places there are and to experience these things, and ultimately to share them with you and share them with your audience and share them with as many people as possible and just show them that, hey,
well, what about before I came along? I mean, you were doing this before I ever came along, right?
Yes, that's true. And we had our website, and we were sharing it that way. I mean, it just, we would love to share.
You know, my thing is to hopefully give people a different perspective, especially people that have ghost phenomena taking place. These entities, these ghosts, they were fathers, they were sisters, they were soldiers. You know, they were police officers. They're people, and there is really, unless the person was really mean when they were alive, there really is nothing to be afraid of. It's a phenomena. People that experience it tend to be horrified of it, and I can't think of anything worse than living in a place that you're afraid to be in. And unless it's a wicked mean, there aren't that many of them.
Well, all right. Observation, though. You have had some grumps. There's no doubt about that.
Yes, there are grumps, and we've come across those.
But here's what I'm getting at. I hope to live for some time yet. I'm 58. It'd be all right to see 88, right?
Yes.
Another 30 years, whatever.
Yes.
Well, okay. When I die, I don't want to be a shriveled up old little guy that I'm going to be when I die. But when I hear your EVPs, it seems like children are children, grumpy old men are grumpy old men, and it sounds like we make a chronological jump, and we're still whatever we are when we die. So, you know, the old saying of die young, leave a pretty corpse or whatever, sounds like it might have merit.
Well, there have been occasions where the same ghost has been seen in different stages of life, and I don't understand what that is.
Well, that's hopeful.
I don't know if it's the frame of mind they're in at the time when we happen to record them.
I want to go sailing into Ghostville in my prime. Well, all right, not a lot of time for the top of the hour, but time enough. Number 12.
All right, now this was also in the mausoleum. And at the beginning of this clip, you're going to hear Barbara talking about her videotape, and I couldn't even understand what she was saying. She was off in the background, and all of a sudden, after she gets done talking about her videotape, this loud, gruff old man's voice comes in and says, "That for Katie." It's almost like he's asking, "Is that for Katie?"
Huh. Great. Here we go. Oh, man. That is totally creepy. Totally creepy. That
you can hear the echo.
Yeah, what's neat about that is if you listen to the acoustics on that.
I was listening. I could hear, where you're in a mausoleum,
yeah.
Obviously there's going to be a big echo. I hear
right.
It on your voice, but to hear it on the ghost's voice...
I think that was pretty interesting where it echoes like that.
So do I. Once again, straight from the mausoleum. Listen carefully. This one's a creep out for sure, folks. That's creepy. A mausoleum is creepy. Now, I know that you two are sort of wrong phrase in the business, but this is your passion. It's what you do, but still in all, going into graveyards and mausoleums, that's creepy. I mean, aren't you all creeped out, or are you so...
You know, honestly, I can... not think of anything I'd rather be doing than on a warm summer night going and getting a hamburger and sitting in the cemetery.
Yeah, great.
And we do that quite often.
Really? So then the spirits don't mind your munching down if necessary.
No, they don't seem to.
How can you account? I mean, if there was the same... mausoleum echo on the ghost voice as yours, then that would imply that it was as every bit as acoustic as yours, and yet you didn't hear it, right?
Yeah,
in real life?
That's correct.
We didn't hear it. So, and we've had plenty of those clips where there's an echo to the voice that matches the echo of us, but we never heard it. And, I mean, how do you explain that? I mean, it just boggles your mind when you think about
There's
it.
There's obviously laws still to learn about that we have no concept of.
What percentage of the EVPs do one of you go, "Oh my God, did you hear that?" or something like that, where you actually did hear a portion of it?
It's very, very rare. I would say
there's been the occasions, but
maybe 1-2% would be it.
Is it as rare as seeing a spirit?
Yes.
Yes.
All right, well, all right, hold it right there. We're at the top of the hour. From the high desert in the middle of the night, the Ghost Investigating Society, GIS, is right here.
Subscribe to After Dark. Call toll-free 1-888-727-5505. We'll be right back.
Creatures of the Night.
To talk with Art Bell, call the Wildcard Line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
An electronic voice phenomena. In other words, voices from the other side of the grave. And I just got an email from Rich who said, hey, forget those truckers. I'm a night watchman. I'm the only one out here. Thanks for the subject. It totally freaks me out. Last time they were on, I had a creepy feeling all night long, and now it's here again. Thanks, Rich. Rich, I do understand. In a moment, more, nevertheless, GIS. Here's a logical question from Tim in Pasadena, Texas. Art, do your guests ever visit crime scenes to see if they can pick up voices possibly of the victims, maybe even giving up the name of their killer?
We visited crime scenes before.
Yes.
Not, you know, within the same day that it's happened or anything like that.
Well, what would be... Would that be an advisable thing to do? In other words, if you really did want to pick up the voice of a ghost naming that ghost's killer, would that be the way to do it, or would it not matter? Would time, the passage of time, not matter?
I don't think it would matter. I think, for whatever reason, a ghost just suddenly will decide it's time to leave. And until it's decided that, I don't think it even has a concept of time. I don't think it realizes any time has passed whatsoever. So I don't think, you know, the amount of time that's passed between a crime and the time you go and do an investigation, as long as the ghost is there, it really shouldn't matter at all.
Well, how about putting that on your list of things? I mean, there are a lot of known horrific, horrific crime scenes. That would be very tempting.
We did a location where a horrible crime... It was multiple murder.
Oh, how'd that work out?
We didn't get a thing like that. We didn't pick up any kind of... I don't think we recorded too much EVP there.
No, we did. I think the only real thing that could even be posted on the website was a groaning sound that was recorded in the back of the building where this crime took place. They tore down the building and put a pet shop over it for some reason. And we were in the back of the pet shop and recorded a groaning sound. And I think that's the only real EVP that we record out of this area.
All right, back to our current EVP, number 13.
Okay, on this one, we were in a mausoleum, and you're going to hear me. I was complaining about leaving one of my favorite flashlights, and you'll hear me say, yeah, I like that flashlight. I had left it at a previous location, another place, and I had forgot it.
You guys discovered the C-Crane LED flashlights, yeah? I'm serious. They'd be really good.
Well, I don't doubt that, actually.
I'll have to look into this.
You should. They'll last many times longer. Anyway, plug aside. couldn't resist.
I like that flashlight. And there's a child's voice that comes in, and it sounds to me like it says, "Ride on. I want it."
I'm on it?
I want it.
Oh, I want it. Okay, let's listen.
Yeah, I like that flashlight.
Oh, God, I don't know why I'm laughing. All right, now, to me, as I listen to that, the I want it at the end is very clear. I'm not sure about right on, but maybe, but the rest of it is very clear to me. One more time.
Yeah, I like that flashlight.
It's a kid, no doubt. There's also a kind of an eerie background sound to that. Is that a digital artifact that we're hearing that's sort of, aside from the echo, and aside from the child's voice, a kind of an eerie...
That one, actually, I think that was actually an analog recording.
Okay.
So, yeah, there was a hiss reduction done on that,
okay.
Which kind of produces that sound.
All right, very good. Yeah, definitely, again, a very, very much a child's voice, unmistakably a child's voice. All right, let's keep moving. The next one, 14.
All right, well, once again, this was recorded in the mausoleum, and you're going to hear Jenny say, "What was that?" And previous to this, she had thought that she had heard a kid's voice, and it didn't pick up on the tape at all. But you're going to hear her say, "What was that?" And then I say, "Huh?" And she says, "What was that? It sounded like a little kid."
Mm-hmm.
And then after this, you hear a man say, it sounds exactly like he's saying, "Very painful."
A man's voice. All right.
What was that?
That sounds like a woman's voice to me.
Really?
Yes. It does sound like very painful. I get that, but it sounds like a woman's voice. Here you go.
What was that?
Doesn't that sound feminine?
Very painful.
I don't know. It sounds feminine to me. Very painful, no question about it.
Mm-hmm.
You see, to me, I wouldn't think that a ghost would have the concept of painful unless it meant in an emotional way.
I would think that I would have to agree with you. But you look how much pain people go through mentally.
Yes, true. All right, number 15.
In this one, Jenny was showing a lady that had accompanied us into a mausoleum, this room that had a dirt floor, and you'll hear Jenny say, "See, it's all dirt in here, in there."
Mm-hmm.
And a man's voice comes in and says, "I see."
Oh, really? Okay, here we go. Oh, that's not good. That's not good. That's a ghostly whisper without question. Listen, whispering. I don't like whispering. Definitely whispering, wouldn't you say?
Yes.
Oh, gee. All of this sounds so creepy, guys. Creepy.
It's your interpretation of it. It's not creepy when you're there, really.
Yeah. You know, to me, it's creepy. They're disembodied voices from the other side. If that's not in creepy category, then what is?
Well, I think it's probably people's perspective of it.
Yes, I think you really have a little bit of disagreement about this, don't you? In other words, Barbara, you tend to think of this all very positively for the most part, and Brendan, not quite so much.
I don't know if I would say that.
You're both really positive about this. I mean, come on, some of the stuff that's being said here is leaning toward a sort of a darker picture of what's going on over there. I mean, like, very painful. Okay, physically or emotionally, either way, that's not a, you know, we don't think of that as a good thing, for example. Or some of the attitudes, I mean, get the hell out of here, or something like that. That's not...
Yes, but you run across that with living people every day.
Yes. But they're living, and so you can okay. Number 16.
Okay. Well, on this one, this was in a mausoleum also. And this kind of could bring you back to what you were mentioning before about the power of suggestion.
Yes.
Because when I heard this on the tape, well, first of all, I'll set it up. You're going to hear a guy saying... this was a guy that accompanied us to the mausoleum, saying, "Can you come out and talk to us, please?"
Uh-huh.
And then afterwards, you hear, it's an odd-sounding voice of a woman that sounds like, "Colton, get back here." Now, when I first heard this, I wondered if I was hearing "Colton, get back here" because I have a nephew named Colton. And I wasn't sure if maybe that's just why I was hearing this.
Right.
But when I played it for everybody else, they all heard the same thing. And it was before I had even mentioned what I thought it said.
Well, let's see how strong the power of your suggestion is. Colton, get back here is what you're listening for.
Can you come out and talk to us, please? Colton? Colton, get back here.
Yeah.
Colton, get back here. Colton?
Okay, in my mind, no question about it. Perhaps I was suitably introduced to what I was about to hear, but it sounds exactly like Colton, get back here.
Can you come out and talk to us, please?
Sure. I'll go along with that. Colton, get back here. So Colton is not exactly a common name.
No, it isn't.
So did that hit you personally?
It did. Because, like I mentioned before, I do have a nephew with that name.
Exactly.
And when I heard it, I mean, that was just instantly was what I heard. I mean, just the second I heard it, I didn't even have to play it twice to go, well, that's what I think it's saying. And then I played it over and over, and that's definitely it. So when I played it for everybody else and they heard the same thing, it just kind of shocked me in a way.
Have the two of you developed the sense that the ghosts on the other side of whatever it is can see us, that they can see us clearly, that they see our world as with theirs, mixed in with theirs?
I think in a way they can. I think that they can see us sometimes very clearly, and other times it's just like how we see their world. It's bits and pieces of it.
I think that they're very aware of us.
Is there any indication that the barrier between us is breaking down, that you're getting more and more EVPs, that communication is increasing, or is it always, do you believe, at a steady pace?
That would be hard one to answer. There's times when we go to locations where we know there's activity and we won't get anything. And I believe that there are conditions that I don't know what the conditions are, but I believe that there are conditions that allow activity to take place at certain times.
Number 17. We want to try to get some phone calls before the program ends. So number 17.
All right. This is in Deer Lodge Prison up in Montana.
Back to prison.
I was relating a story about a prisoner that I had read about in an article. The name of the article was Too Evil to Live. It was about this terrible man, and you're going to hear me talking about him. I mean, every time he'd go to a different location, he was known by a different name at each prison from other prisons. And every prison he was incarcerated in, he escaped from. And this man's voice was recorded, and he sounds like he knew the man. He goes, "Oh, yes."
Huh.
And this man, he was incarcerated in this prison for, I believe it was a year and a half.
Really?
Or obviously, like Barbara mentioned, he did escape.
Well, let's let everybody make their own judgments. Here you go. Now that sounds like a voice from that prison, clearly saying, "Oh yes," as though he recognized exactly what you had just said. I mean, it was just a, yes, that seems like a direct response, absolute direct response to what you said, doesn't it?
Yes.
Oh, yes, you might say. Here we go.
I mean, every time he'd go to a different location, he was known by a different name at this prison from other prisons that he was at, and every prison he was incarcerated in, he escaped from.
Yeah, you know, it would imply, of course, that the prisoners remain in the area that had imprisoned them in life, and they remain there.
It would seem like some of them are still there.
There's a funny thing about prisoners. You know, there are some men who have gone to prison, and when they got out, they had been so indoctrinated into prison life that they no longer wished to be on the outside. Prison was all they knew and loved, frankly, and they would commit crimes to actually get back in prison.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I think, especially for the ones that had been locked up for 30, 40 years, I think there was a certain level of insanity that would happen.
Perhaps.
That would happen to them. And exactly what you said, they would try whatever they could to get back into prison because they'd become institutionalized.
So maybe even in death they stay in their prison.
Exactly.
How much of an attempt have you all made to discover what you can about the nature of what these ghosts are living in? I mean, have you ever asked questions hoping for specific answers about the environment, about what it's like?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we do quite frequently ask, what is it like where you're at? You know, things like that. And we have never, to those kinds of questions, gotten a real response. The closest we ever came was we had a woman say, "It's cold." And that was it. That's the only response we've ever had to that question.
It's cold. Well, automatically, I don't like that. And never again, once again, never any indication of anybody having moved on from where they were. In other words, no follow-up kind of stuff where whoever you talk to is gone and someone says they're gone.
No. But we have had cases where we would go to a location and record the same person's voice, you know, on three separate occasions. And then we would go back and never record that person again.
Well, maybe that's hopeful.
Yeah.
You know, they got up and moved on up. All right. The GIS in the middle of the night. I'm Art Bell.
Access the audio archives of Coast to Coast AM. Log on to coasttocoastam.com. Code 775-727-1295. The first time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call Art at 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art Bell by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
We've got about three more electronic voice phenomena cuts to get through here, and then we'll turn it over to you and let you ask any questions you might have. And I'm sure you'll have questions. Who wouldn't, based on what we're listening to? Once again, Barbara Macbeth and Brendan Cook in the GIS and voices from the other side. And I think we've got, three more cuts here.
Yeah.
So let's do them. Again, these are voices recorded from the other side on either analog or digital equipment. And the motives of the people you're listening to are quite pure, unimpeachable, really. So here we go. Number 18.
All right. Well, this was also in the Deer Lodge prison, and it was in the maximum security section of the prison.
Oh.
Which I'm sure I don't have to tell you the kinds of things that went on there. And what's interesting about this is, well, actually two things. One, women were housed in this area before they turned it into the maximum security section.
Oh.
For two, this is a woman's voice, and it sounds like she's screaming, saying, "Oh, God." Now, what's weird about this, and almost creepy in a way, mm-hmm. is this was recorded by a tape recorder that was just left in the maximum security section of the prison. There was nobody around when this was recorded. It was silent for about 20 minutes until this voice came in, and it was silent afterwards.
Really? All right, here we go. Hmm. not good at all. Not at all. That's an echo. You know, I just said something interesting, an echo. That's something somebody else fast-blasted me a little while ago. Instead of being a real-time event from a consciousness on the other side, perhaps aware or not aware of the passage of time, could it be an echo of something not real, but something left, like a molecular memory of some sort, or I don't know, you know, but
residual type of a thing.
Yes, ma'am.
And it's very possible.
There are times that we've recorded things like that. The majority of the time, I do believe it is something intelligent.
But this is a scream of torture.
And this one very well could be residual.
Listen, listen. It's torture. Clearly torture. Yeah, that's torture, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Huh.
And I would hope that it's residual and not somebody in that much anguish still there.
But if some of it is residual, it all could be.
No, I don't think so, because we get
contemporary information,
and we also get immediate responses to things that we're talking about and doing.
You've even had ghosts tell people where things are, haven't you?
Yes.
Yes.
And we've also had ghosts tell a license plate number or something. The one case I'm thinking about is we were in a cemetery, and there was a car parked up. In fact, I think it was the car that we were talking about in the clip earlier.
Yes.
Parked up at the top of the cemetery. And we were wondering what he was doing there. And Jenny had said, get his license plate number.
Yes.
And we got an EVP starting to read off the license plate number.
And also, we recorded a voice that told us about plastic eyes that we had no idea about.
Oh, that was horrible. I remember the plastic eyes. Horrible. That was in a mortuary, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, oh, that was really awful. All right, number 19.
On this one, this is at the prison, and you're going to hear Jenny say she was referring to a guard.
Yes.
That had worked there, and she says he probably did what they deserved. He probably gave them what they deserved. And
yeah.
There's a voice that was recorded. It says, we sat back to back.
Oh, here we go.
He probably did what they deserved. Probably did what they deserved.
There's no question about what that just said. They sat back to back. Any idea what they were referring to?
I think that was a form of punishment.
Yeah.
Or
in the prison.
Yes.
And I think especially in the solitary confinement area.
Uh-huh.
In the maximum security area, I think they would tie them back to back.
Once again.
He probably did what they deserved. Probably did what they deserved.
God, that is so eerie. All right, the final one. I want to get to a couple of calls at least here.
This last one, this was sent in to us by a woman named Edie Doppel, and she's a member of our message board.
And she gave you permission to give her name?
Yes.
Okay.
And this was the lady I was talking about earlier, that originally her and her husband had heard us on your show and decided they were going to prove us wrong and show us how full of it we are.
That's right, yeah.
And she recorded this voice in a cemetery, and you're going to hear the voice come in first. And it's a male's voice that says, Thomas. And then she finishes saying, but I did hear you. And she's referring to a voice that she had heard earlier on her recording.
Okay, here we go.
Thomas? But I did hear you. Thomas?
I mean, quite clearly, Thomas. Okay, that's about as much of one night of this as I can handle anyway. It puts you in a mood, I'll tell you what. It really does. First time caller line, you're on the air with the GIS. Hi there.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm just wondering, what's the most, the oldest place these have recorded?
Now, you're going to have to speak up, sir. I can barely hear you. Yell at me. What's the question?
What's the oldest place these people have tried recording at?
The oldest place, okay. The oldest location, you guys. I think
the oldest location is probably the Rawlins Prison in Wyoming. And I believe it was built in 1880-something.
Does the age of the location appear to have any difference in the amount of EVP that you...
No. No, because we've gone to homes that are under construction that's had activity, that's never had, in recorded history, had a building on it. So it makes me wonder if it's sometimes associated with the land itself.
Or whether you are the attraction.
Well, that could be.
In trying to figure this out, a few things ought to be apparent. I mean, is there any one place you'd say we get more EVP here than anywhere else?
Not really. There's locations that we've gone to where we haven't recorded EVP at all, even on follow-up investigations, but that hasn't happened too often.
Okay. Wildcard line, you're on the air with the GIS. Hi.
Hello, Art and Brendan, Barbara. This has to do with a cut you ran earlier in regards to the mortuary where they had seen a ghost wandering around by their little boy's room.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And on track 6, where you thought it was, you said it sounded like it was saying to Evanston.
Yes.
It sounds more like she's trying to send you, since you're moving the camera around, to Evan's room, move up.
Oh, now that's a good...
Yeah.
We'll have to find out what his son's name is.
Yeah, or whoever's son was that lived there before, whoever little ghost boy is.
Yeah, that's another good question. How often do you all do research when you get a name or something, or a place or something, where you can go to living witnesses and say, hey, does this have meaning from somebody who was here or whatever?
Oh, any time that we can do that,
yeah, we do.
We do.
The house itself, it's a brand new home. He built the home there. There was no home ever standing there before. But Evans, we'll have to ask him if that's his son's name.
Caller, what do you think when you hear all of this? I mean, what do you think you're listening to?
It sounds like something out of MGM Sound Studio sometimes, you know. it's done really well, but you have to buy it. I mean, I've got a few creepy plots around here, you know, real old cemeteries.
Yes.
And, well, we tried doing that, but got no response. But I think the problem is down here is that nobody alive really wants to talk to you, so why would you say?
I never thought of it that way. All right, thank you very much. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with GIS. Good morning.
Hi, this is Joe in Nashville.
Hey there, Joe.
Where I live here is very close to the original Battle of Nashville Confederate lines, and I was just wondering if had ever tried anything around you know, known battlefields, and along the same lines, they had mentioned that some work had been done in Germany, and I wondered if maybe they had heard anything about the Ardennes Forest or even possibly one of the former sites of the concentration camps, what kind of things might be there.
Well, to answer your last question, I do know that there are some German researchers that have done EVP recordings at, say, where Auschwitz was, and where concentration camps were. We've even had them send us pictures of some of the ovens that are in the concentration camps. And they showed orbs in them. One even showed what looked like a shadow, or a shadow person, I guess. As far as your first question, we haven't done a whole lot of battlefields.
We've gone to areas that have had
cowboy and Indian type
massacres
take
yeah.
place.
And what do you get there?
We actually, I don't think
we haven't received anything.
You know, I guess everybody's wondering, do you get battle-related EVPs?
We picked up what sounded like drums in the prison. That mm-hmm. prison, one of the prisons that we went to, was originally ran by soldiers, and they did use drums to mm-hmm. for when the prisoners would be marching from location to location. And we did record drums, sound like marching drums, in that prison. But that is it.
All right. Your website again is ghostpix.com, GHOSTPIX,
That's right.
And your challenge is go up there and suck up the bandwidth, and let's see if we really got
See how we hold up.
Yeah, download all our videos and just have fun with them.
West of the Rockies, you're on the air with GIS. Hello.
Art, how are you?
Just fine.
Pleasure to talk to you, my friend. Brendan and Barbara, I've got a question for you. I understand you're from Utah.
That's correct.
What part, if you don't mind me asking?
We're from Ogden.
Is that right? Because I'm calling from Ogden, Utah right now myself.
Are you?
It might be down the street from where we are.
I'm up on Washington Boulevard, North Washington. I've actually got a question for you. I used to work in the old hotel. I don't know if I can disclose the name, but I used to work in the old hotel on 25th Street.
Uh-huh. Okay.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yes, we've done many investigations there.
Have you? And I was wondering what turned up, because I myself, I've never seen anything weird, but they've actually... they've denied publicly, I don't know if you've noticed this, but they've denied publicly that it is haunted. They've denied publicly that there are things actually underneath the hotel, like passageways, tunnels, and whatnot. I myself have been down there, and I was wondering if you guys have and what your findings were.
Well, if you go to our website, we do have EVP posted on our site from that hotel. Some of them have the original name of the hotel. Some of them are posted with the original name. And this was back when the owner had allowed us to do it before it was taken over by someone else. Mm-hmm. And other ones just refer to an old historic hotel.
There you go, caller. You might want to go up to the website and check some of those out since you've been there.
Thanks a lot, Art.
Have a good morning. First time caller line, you're on the air with GIS. Hello.
Hi, how's it going?
Just quite well, thank you.
All right. I had a question. I was wondering if you guys have ever... been somewhere where you have had two tape recorders going at the same time,
mm-hmm.
and if both of them have picked up an EVP, or if one will catch it and the other won't?
Yep, very good question, guys.
Constantly. We always have more than one tape recorder going, or digital recorder.
We have at least five going if there's the five of us.
Yeah. And there are times when we will all pick up the same voice if we're all in the same area. And there's other times when only one of us will pick up the same voice.
Where the others should have picked it up and didn't.
Is there a wide difference in the volume? Do you sometimes get very loud ones, or are they almost always, we got to pick this up out of the noise, we got to get it out of the noise, we can hear it as way down there?
We do sometimes get extremely loud voices.
You do?
They'll be louder than us.
Really?
In fact, the one that we played tonight, the one that says that for Katie.
Yes.
I mean, that was obviously louder than any of us.
Very loud, yes.
But you're right. The majority of the time, they are fairly low, and they are lower than we are.
And there's some that we can't use on the show because you'd never hear them, no matter what we do.
Or do you think, I mean, do you think that it means there's a physical distance between the ghost and the pickup device, whatever it is that's actually picking it up, the microphone or the unit itself?
There's been times when it's closer to one person than the others. The others will pick it up, but it won't be as loud as the one that we use.
Well, with humans, the closer to the mic, the louder the recording.
Right.
But I wonder if that's true of ghosts as well. I mean, that just implies a whole acoustic world as we understand it. Which isn't necessarily true on the other side. So maybe it's just the way they project it. I don't know. I'm fishing around. And I guess you guys don't really know either, do you?
No, we don't. We can give
theories on it as to why, but there are times when one person will have it louder on their recorder than the rest.
Gotcha. Okay. Wildcard line, you're on the air with GIS. Hello. Hello?
Okay, how are you?
Okay, sir.
All right, fantastic show, but I'd like to ask a fast, pertinent question here to the GIS folks here. My name is Alan. I'm in Newington, Connecticut.
Far away.
What happens is I go out to the plots. Yes, that does work, and I don't need a radio on, and I get voices. But when I'm in my house, I have to turn a radio on, and I still do EVPs from my own house. Have they ever heard of any such thing?
Could you repeat that last part?
For one thing, turn your radio off, sir. Yeah, that's always like a thing to do before you get on the air. Turn it off.
Are you there?
Yes, turn the radio off, please.
Yes, what happens is I get the EVPs from the plots, and I don't need a radio on. But when I'm in my house, I still do EVPs, but I need a radio on in the background.
Well, wouldn't that be something that would tend to pollute any possible EVP you would do to have a radio on in the background?
Yeah, because a lot of the time you could get a skipping signal, just little pieces of a conversation or a talk show breaking in.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely, that would be the kind of pollution you'd avoid at 10,000%. And I know that's what you all do, is avoid that.
Yeah, and what he's referring to is when EVP research, and some people still do this, when it first started, there was a theory that you needed some sort of white noise in the background to help ghosts produce noise.
Yes.
That since they didn't have their own vocal cords, they had to use some ambient noise and produce a sound with
it. And sort of modulate it, yeah.
Exactly. And so I think that's what he's referring to.
Okay. Oh, I see. All right. Sort of a basis that they can... We're out of time. I really appreciate you two being here tonight. Thank you so much. And
thank you.
And have a good ghostly night.
Thank you, Mark.
Take care. All right, well, that's it, folks. I'm sorry, we're out of time tonight. We'll be back tomorrow night, same time, same station. Major Ed Danes. I'm Art Bell.
Riders on the storm. Riders on the storm. Into this house we're born. Into this world we're thrown. Like a dog without a bone.
Do ever...